So today we're just going to do a short follow-up on a video that I'd previously done on passphrase recovery. So this is the process you can use to recover your BIP39 passphrase if you've forgotten it, or maybe it's called your 25th word or the password for your hidden wallet, depending on the hardware wallet you're using. And all of the notes for what you need to start this time are the same as my last video on it, so you will need to have a correct 24-word seed. You will need to know one address that you used with your wallet. So let's say for all of these examples, you know, that we'd purchased some Ethereum on Coinbase, we looked at our emails or we logged into Coinbase to see where we had sent it to. Like all the other ones, you need to download BTCRecover, create an air-gapped environment if you want to do this securely, and I've got some videos that show you how to do that. So once you've set up your environment, there are two general approaches we're going to look at. And the first one is basically a 100% brute force based approach. So that's going to be where we have a token file that's full of just individual letters, and we're just putting them together in different combinations to brute force a password. And that works okay for shorter passwords, which some people might have used, particularly if you're just interested in like a plausible deniability style passphrase setup. The second thing we're going to look at are different types of dictionary attacks. And these can work effectively for long, complex passphrases. We can use a few different types of dictionaries with different types of words in them. And we can also start to try different combinations of words in a sort of brute force style. So we're going to look at two different ways that we can use that. So firstly, via a password list file. So that's where it just runs through the dictionary basically from start to finish. And you know, it could be a dictionary list, it could be a list of frequently used English words, it could be a password dump that's been leaked or compiled from previous website hacks. So there's like a RockYou list and a PHPBB list that we'll be referencing later, which can be really useful because, you know, they have a lot of passwords that people commonly pick. And, you know, it could be something like using the Diceware lists, if you'd used Diceware, or even just making a list that's full of, you know, names, family members, pets, passwords you often use, all those sorts of things. And you can download some of them from here, and that website will be in the description. So the other thing that we're going to look at really quickly is the way that you can use dictionaries sort of in a brute force kind of way. So you can look for multiple words that have been connected together. And this does hit practical limits once the dictionaries start getting quite large. You know, for example, I've said here, you know, you can recover something that's say three dice words off the short word list that they provide, but you know, any more than that, things start getting time consuming. And the important thing, though, is if you look at my previous video, there are rules that you can give around these token files that will speed things up dramatically. So you can help give BTCRecover some guidance around the kinds of characters that might only appear between words, might only appear at the start, might appear at the finish. And it comes down to, I guess, you thinking about the kinds of passwords and the kinds of phrases that you would have strung together. The other thing that's really important to consider when you're doing brute force attacks like this is the kind of hardware you've got at your disposal. And for these tests, I was using a mix of dual core and quad core i5 processors, and also spun up a 48 vCPU Linode. And the reason I added that Linode in there is that, you know, you can buy as a consumer processor now these Ryzen Threadripper CPUs. And when I ran the test, and I'll show you in a sec, you know, this Ryzen processor would be about 10 times faster than the i5 that I was using in these tests. And that can make a huge difference if you have something that might say it's going to take you a year to brute force on like an i5. You know, you could be looking at a month with some of these more high-end processors, and that's before we even consider GPUs or FPGAs. So you can see here that the performance is pretty consistent. So, you know, this is running the same test on the laptop, so it had an ETA of 2 days, the desktop an ETA of 1 day, and as you can see, it was fully utilizing all the cores. And then on the Linode, we can see it was going to take a whole grand total of 3 hours with all 48 vCPUs just running flat out. So that's an important thing to consider when you're just looking at these numbers and trying to work out what is doable in your situation. So we're just going to look at some examples. And for all of these examples, we use this same 24-word seed phrase here, and we're trying to recover some different addresses. So the first one is looking at a short password that we're just going to brute force. So this is just a short 4-character password. I did do tests of, you know, 1, 2, and 3-character passwords, but they were brute forced so quickly that it wasn't even worth showing. So this is one where we're looking for the word coin. And these are the commands we're using with BTC Recover here. So I've not worried about any typos for BTCRecover to do. It's just going to run through all the different combinations of letters and not worry about uppercase or lowercase. And we can see that it worked it out in a minute, and the full run would have taken an hour. And that's the command there. All of these commands will also be in the description down the very bottom as well if you want to copy and paste them and try them yourself. A second similar test is saying, well, maybe we weren't sure about some capitalization, so we would have run the same sort of test again, looking with the same token list, and we add in here this typos case and typos one. So it's going to do all the tests before, but also going to run through and capitalize the different words. And we can see that test took 5 minutes to run. Now, the thing that's really important to understand when we're using BTCRecover this way is we need to tell BTCRecover how many letters we're wanting to try stringing together. And the way we do that is by using this max tokens command here. So basically, we've said max tokens 4, and because we're using that with a token file that's just individual letters, that means it's going to try a maximum of 4 letters together. Likewise, here again, that's still only 4 tokens that we're using together, whereas when we get to some of these ones where we're chaining together sets of tokens out of dictionaries, we need to tell it how many individual words we're wanting to string together. So that only matters when we're using a token list, not a password list. And we can see here that was the 5 letter recovery, so we had 5 tokens. And likewise for these later tests where we're stringing say 2 and 3 words together, we're setting the max tokens to be 2 for the 2 word one and 3 for the other. You really need to make sure you're setting this max tokens command, otherwise you're just going to end up with like stupidly long and complex tests almost straight away. The other thing that you'll notice is again this one down the bottom here, for 3 words strung together, you know, it would have taken a day on the desktop CPU and 3 hours on like a Ryzen Threadripper or a Linode 48 core system. So the token list that I use for example 1 and 2 is really, really straightforward. It's just basically a text file, so tokens bf double.txt, with just one letter per line, and it's just A to Z, 0 to 9, and I've just gone through the alphabet twice. And again, you just need to work out whether you're using dictionary words or using completely random words and letters, and whether you're including maybe special symbols in there or not. Because again, the more of these you add in, the quicker you're going to get into the realm of passphrases that are difficult to brute force. But again, if you're thinking you are likely just to use, you know, normal alphanumeric sort of stuff, then you know, a list like this can be perfectly acceptable for that. So the other thing to consider is if you're wondering which letters and which numbers and which symbols to include on here, it's worth having a look at your hardware wallet and seeing what it supports. So for example, the Trezor allows you to just enter in with your keyboard on your computer the passphrase every time, and you can use just about whatever symbols you like. Whereas with a Ledger wallet, because you're entering it all on the device all the time, they actually only offer a much smaller set of symbols than is actually possible within BIP39 passphrases. So yeah, just have a look and see what are the valid passphrases you could have even entered in the first place, because it might be a smaller character set than you think. So we'll just go on to example 3 and example 4, and essentially what we're looking at here is sort of where you get to that boundary between where a brute force approach will work versus a dictionary approach. And we can see here for this next test we were looking for the word Smith. You know, super common last name. There's no reason why someone might not have just picked that as their passphrase. And we're still using that same tokens BF list double that I talked about earlier. And we're also saying, well, maybe there'll be some capitalization in there because it's a last name. So we run that test. And this is where we have a few different things. So firstly, I ran it via brute force with that same dictionary we see before. It took, you know, 5 hours, but it could have taken 5 days. Bearing in mind this is on an i5 desktop, so what you could achieve with a, you know, multi-core monster is a lot more. It would have taken a lot less time, about a tenth of the time. We can also see that on a dictionary attack, this is now we're using English.txt, so this is just an English dictionary that I got. That took about 32 minutes to run. And the other dictionary that I used for this one was this password list, is this password list called RockU. It comes with some various security-focused distributions of Linux, and you can see it's basically a whole list of passwords that people have been using on websites and things that were leaked or hacked, and it includes some fairly long and complex passwords that, you know, you'd be really unlikely to get using you know, brute force based approaches. But you know, this has got like huge number of passwords in there. And you know, if you just happen, as lots of humans do, to have picked something that you thought was really random, that just happens to be the same thing that a whole bunch of other people just picked because they thought it was random, you might very well find that your super duper secure password is actually on this list. And it's really worth just checking it as well, because who knows, you may have just thought the same as many other hundreds of people before you in picking a password. So that's RockYou. So we can see that RockYou found Smith as well, capitalized in a few seconds. And so what you can see we've done is also for this password list, you can use that in conjunction with having typos that BTCRecover will check. So what we've done here is we've said for each row in the password list file, it's going to assume that two of those letters might have been an uppercase letter. And it doesn't just have to be the first letter or the last letter, any two. And it's going to run through and test all of those. So we can see an example here of that dual capitalization happening here with a password that's a bit longer, and just YouTube for the sake of it. And we can see that we ran it with this command against the RockYou list, and that's what it came up with. So it found it in just a couple of minutes. But the full length run could have taken a couple of days. So I thought we'd do another test as well, which was just the correct horse battery staple, running that against the tokens English list, just to demonstrate that. But that ran out of memory and didn't work. So it's important to realize that once you start using a big long dictionary as a token list, you very quickly start hitting both memory and computation limits. So a 3 MB token list file is just too long for that sort of thing, and we'll see the practical limits of that in a minute. The other two examples we have are examples where we've used a dictionary list. So in this one, we've used the token list 0 to 1000 and had a password that might have strung two words together that are on that list. So correct question. And we can see here that that ran and it found the result in a couple of minutes. And basically, on this one though, it didn't take nearly as long because we weren't bothering to check for capitalization or anything like that. We're just wanting to illustrate connecting multiple tokens together. We see the last example that I'm going to show is basically looking at three words together. And we're using the Google top 500 English words for this one, just to make the dictionary a bit shorter, just to illustrate the point. And we can see that that ran on the laptop. It took about 2 days to run, so that would have taken a day on the desktop and 3 hours on the Ryzen CPU. And I'm going to do another video on this, but I think it really illustrates the importance of using a long dictionary if you're going to be just chaining words together. If you're using a short dictionary file, like even the Diceware short list, you really need to select a decent number of words out of there before an attack on that phrase becomes impractical. So that's probably a really good place to talk about the computational limits for some of this stuff. And it's important to understand that possible passwords, when using a password list like RockYou or something like that, they scale in a linear fashion. If you're using a password list that's twice as long, it'll take twice as long to run. If you're using a password list that's 10 times as long, it'll take 10 times as long to run. So time is basically the speed of your system times the list length. Once you start using a token list, the possible time for it to process scales exponentially. So what that means is that if you double the size of the list, the processing could potentially take 4 times as long. If you increase the size of the token list by 10, the test will take 100 times longer to run. The other thing to understand is the token list increases exponentially with the number of tokens you are looking for. So for example, a 4-word password with a 100-word dictionary will have 100 to the power of 4 options. A 5-word password with a 100-word dictionary will be 100 to the power of 5. So what we can see is that adding one more word by increasing the length of a phrase by 25%, it will take 100 times as long to be processed. I'm going to look more into that on my next video that looks at selecting a good BIP39 passphrase. So my suggested workflow for this would be, number one, to set up the recovery environment to make sure that you know how to make it work, and to try running through some of the examples that I've provided here. And the reason why I say that that's a good thing to do is just to make sure you don't waste a whole month running a test that's actually never going to find the result you want simply because you've got a typo somewhere or have misunderstood some of the arguments for BTCRecover. I'm also going to include the password lists that I used for this on GitHub, so you can actually reproduce all of the tests that I did here just to make sure you've got a firm grasp on how to use these tools before you start using them on your own wallets and phrases. My suggestion is, again, if you've got no idea what your passphrase was, start with trying to brute force something short. Because you might have just picked a password that was easy to remember that was mostly about plausible deniability, and you can create a token list with letters in it, or just download the one I've put on GitHub. My next suggestion would be to try a couple of different dictionaries just for dictionary attacks, like the ROCU list, just as a password list. And also, if that doesn't get you a result, create yourself a token list with every password, every family member name, every nickname, friends, pets, all of those things, and stuff that you might use in passwords, and start doing a multiple token sort of attack on that. So if you're someone who might have strung together two or three of those kinds of things to make a password, that can be a really common thing. And you just have to look through the password lists in things like ROCU to see that a lot of people do that. The other thing I'd say is be really selective about the kinds of typos that you want to try and have BTCRecover check. In my previous video, it was sort of assumed that you had a pretty good idea about what your passphrase was, and you were really just trying to recover from a typo or a slight misremembering or something like that. Whereas if you're trying to do brute force and dictionary-based stuff, having BTCRecover run through and like check for missing letters, check for letters that have been pressed twice, check for caps lock and all that sort of stuff can be extremely time consuming. So just be really selective about the kinds of typos you want BTCRecover to check. The other note that I think I would add is concerning cloud servers, you really need to understand the risks. So if you're presented with a test that you are pretty sure will recover your passphrase, but it's going to take months, paying for a cloud-based server or finding someone or buying a high-end CPU to run these tests can be cost-effective. I just use Linode, and I've put a link to them in the description. It's just important that you understand that the process of using BTCRecover exposes both your 24-word seed and potentially your passphrase onto the system you're running them on. So if you do use a cloud-based server to do these kinds of recoveries, one of your first priorities should be to move all of your funds onto a brand new wallet, so brand new 24-word seed, brand new passphrase, because you should assume that the ones that were exposed to this hired server have been compromised, or at least could very easily be in the future. I think it's important to acknowledge from the outset that trying to do a brute force recovery with your passphrase should be considered a fairly low odds play, and it's not something that has any guarantees of success at all, but it is also a good thing to do just to help satisfy yourself that you've done everything you can to try and recover your funds. Thanks for watching. I hope that was helpful. Just hit subscribe if you'd like to be kept in the loop about future content I make to help people stay safe in the crypto space and to recover if they get into trouble. Or if there's a question you'd like some more information about or a topic you'd like me to cover in the future, just leave a reply.